I admit I feel a bit torn between the options that I have in front of me. Having listened to various speakers in the morning and the debate that it generated, brought a few thoughts, especially with regard to my being a practicing artist. And so I thought that I would perhaps comment on some of these and then do some ruminating. But then you have something else here. If I say that it was a heavy duty discourse, I mean it. And I mean that it's something which dislodges me in some way to reflect upon issues which are larger. I don't know how to begin and how to end. There may be just questions, or there may be just reflections. Thinking aloud, having belonged to what you may roughly call the word that has been now has become quite popular, called visual culture. When it really dissected, you find that it is a segment of that visual culture to which some of us belong. It is in that sense a minority culture. I'm just putting it in numerical terms. And in a way it is associated with a particular kind of culture and particular kind of ideas associated with what, quote unquote, modern. One can bring in several other discourses along with that. And that culture has existed as I grew up from 60s onwards and observing my seniors and my peers fighting, or shall we say, odds. My dear friend Bhupen Kakkar had to subsist on doing a job as an accountant because he was trained as a chartered accountant until about 78 or so. After having painted Guru Jayanti and several others, he was still working as an assistant accountant in Jyoti Limited and Bharat Linda in Baroda while painting at home. And then you know the story of liberalization that everybody speaks about, and the arrival of the auction houses, if I may put it that way, not to speak of other forces that accompanied, that it accompanied. And then there are the media. There are the media reports. For the first time, there were two things, let me tell you, that earlier, whenever there was an exhibition, there was either somebody who was an art critic or whoever he was or she was, wrote a short review, which almost all newspapers had. They were paid a pittance of something like 100 rupees or even less. It was very interesting that after the market opens, so to say, that the market came into the picture, and my friend then was able to give up his job and could then live on sale of his work, that we also learned that gradually many a newspaper stopped publishing art reviews. The reason being, artists don't need any publicity. We don't need artists, perhaps, I say, or we don't need art, because it doesn't bring any revenue, or whatever it is. And then there began a whole process of what the market brings in the world of art, the galleries. Number of galleries mushroomed, and it reached its peak. I mean, it began in a small way, around 2002 and 2003, it reached its peak when the prices were phenomenally increased. To such an extent that galleries even told us that we were underpricing our work. Because they were not doing enough business, you know, from our work. And look at your, you know, your juniors. So that was the kind of climate that I observed over the years. But what we wanted to paint, for instance, from, let us say, if I take a cut-off period as 1970, that's both Bhupen and I when we were in Baroda. Bhupen began to discover his sexuality around that period of time and began to paint. You know, if you know the painting called You Can't Please All, it's something which is indicative of that, that the nude man standing outside in a balcony declaring himself. Well, I did my own thing and I also found my way. We had very few takers, very few who would either write about us. Interestingly, both Bhupen and I write in Gujarati. We are sufficiently known as Bhupen as a short story writer and I as a poet. But even Gujarati writing did not cover art. It was because we insisted, so they would sometimes bring it and some of the journals would. But journals have a very limited limited appeal, and it's also sort of, it's a 500 to 750 copies. So that is where it reaches. So it is another minority culture to which it belongs. But then when this whole business of market opened, suddenly it was the pricing that brought art somewhere in a region which now people say that it area extended from the upper class to the, or to a select few, to a larger community of readers, especially middle class, who were sort of, you know, taken aback and they would not know how to deal with it, you know, because they had perhaps seen that there are some crazy people who do such things. But now those things that those crazy people do bring such an amount of money. And this is something which is associated in the popular mind. We received all kinds of queries and all that, and I know that my friend was so amazingly tactical about both his sexuality. You know, he could paint his yayati, you know, which had two nude men, and keep it open in his house. And he, being a very soft-spoken and very nice and very simple man who was, he had gray hair, white hair, in fact, so he would go for a very elderly person than what he was. At that, even the middle class Gujaratis who lived nearby would not object. But the same painting, when it was taken to Kemal, they had to put it in a separate room. They could not show it there. So what was happening? We were slightly taken aback. Something which can be, you know, here openly in his middle class locality, and something which in a sort of whatever you call it, Jahangir Art Gallery and Kemal Gallery on the first floor, had to hide it. Similarly, even here, you know, and I would not cite all the examples, but let me come back to Baroda, and I would say that when it opened, when it began to open, then suddenly we began to witness many other viewers, which we did not, or the viewers who witnessed others did not view us, and now somewhere there was a kind of a tete-a-tete. And that is where all kinds of issues cropped up, and particularly with regard to education. I remember when I was teaching, Bhupen had made a print, which is again a very explicit print. It's called Intimacy. And it was there in the classroom and all the students. Nobody ever bothered. But if that situation, which gradually, let us say, let me tell you first that it was a combination of the market opening and the type of new middle class culture that that had come to the fore. It was also accompanied by an increasing instance of communalism. It's not that communalism didn't exist, but it came on the surface and it began to show in various ways. For instance, it was after the 69 riots in Ahmedabad that I came to know about it, because then I came to be known by my name. Until then, I did not, because that we lived in a kind of a Nehruvian sort of syncretic world of sort. So from the 80s onwards, one began to notice that that was a gradual rise in the city of Baroda and elsewhere. So there were multiple forces which were rising, and we noticed them. Well, what we did was another thing, but what we did was to have sort of protests. What we did was to make posters. What we did was to try to explain to people, etc., as artists. And as you know, the story of Sahmat. It was a similar story in Baroda, but that story, in a way, came to a flashpoint later, in about 10 years' time, in 2002. And we realized that now, whatever that we did was suspect. In that sense, you then, at one level, found a kind of a new world, new... And let me again use the example of Bhupen Kakkar. He built his own house, he lived now comfortably, he had everything, and many other artists, young artists too. So there came some amount of money with which many an artist were able to do very ambitious kind of work which they would not have been able to do earlier. But alongside came all these forces which began to rise right in front of our nose. And it is very difficult. I have no answer. I don't have actually a clear picture of it as to how it works, where it works, and in which measure it works, that even in a town like Baroda, a particular region has its own particular type of response. It's not the city of Baroda. And within that, there is a community in which we had functioned for something like 30 years without being threatened, without ever being threatened. So what happens when some non-entity, you know, who has some legal, whatever it is, you know, comes to the Faculty of Fine Arts and finds that a work in an examination is objectionable, and then he brings police with him. Now, how do you explain? Where do you explain? Where do you, you know, put it in which? So what is, we are talking about mobs and democracy. In one sense, they all came together and the entire city of Baroda was agog. Fine Arts College, where I taught for nearly 30 years, you know, in the university hierarchy was at the lowest, because university did not consider even its existence. Because, you know, we didn't figure. It was, in that sense, again using the same word minority, that it was a small institution with something like 400 to 500 students. They talked about it when something appeared in the press. And now what appeared in the press, you know, made them aware of this institution in a different sort of way. And the city of Baroda came to know of the Faculty of Fine Arts, you know, which it had never bothered to find out. And they said, ah, this is what they do. So I'm going back to the thing that it is, what do you do? How do you work? What do you work? I mean, if I use the idea of sexuality in the case of Bhupen Kakkar, or if I use the idea of, let us say, political content in the work of another artist, then these become pronounced. These became pronounced as the situation grew, and that we found ourselves in a situation where we, I don't know. The questions that arose were like this. Firstly, how shall we pursue what we are doing? Shall we be able to pursue, or shall we be able to do what we are doing? Because one of the things that is of prime importance for I can speak for myself, or I can speak for Bhupen to some extent, say that, look, we wanted to do what we had decided to do, no matter what happens. I suppose every artist worth his grain thinks of that, you know, every writer worth his grain also thinks that. But how would you do it? You know, where would you hide it? Would you show it here? You would not show it in the city of Baroda. So you would only show it outside. Or nowadays, in some cases, as I have heard, that you show all these things abroad, which you would not. In some cases, I know that Atul Dodia has faced the problem. I know that there are other artists have faced the problem. Then what do you do? There are two options. One is, you find a way to either find a way to deal with the situation or evolve a language which allows you to say what you want to say. No, wait. So you will have to devolve. You have to actually create a new language. And in that, I think video has come as a handy tool. In some cases, not everybody, but in some cases it has come. So technology has fed into that. See? But at the same time, when I was listening to a friend, the perils of using that thing. You know, there's something, you know, which you pointed out so succinctly today, you know, is not often recognized, that you literally take it as if it is an innocent medium, which it is not, you know. And here brings the, you know, the whole issue of either medium is message or it is question of means and end, that sometimes the means overtake the ends. And that you try to bring, or you try to seek all your answers in your means. And if the means take the form of ends, there is likely to be a very serious problem. And I find that there are similar issues which have arisen. And so today, you know, if the exposure is such, suppose if it is through, I don't know, let me bring it in a different way. The video and the and the rest of the electronic or the type of work which could be fed into that territory are viewed by everybody. Is art per se, or art I'm talking about, does it circulate? Only a portion of it. It was only Hussein because he was under attack. That was, but that is not circulating. It still remains a small, or perhaps somewhere outside. You know. So in the larger explosive domain, you know, of the IT culture, whatever you wish to say, that art still functions. That when art finds its, art fights its own battles. Now, if we have to put it all together and see that why and how, you know, to respond, how to respond to this, there are all these issues that stand in front of you. It's not without that, you know, that you live in a city, live in a place like Sadanand also mentioned the state of Gujarat and everything. Now, it is also the culture of fear that has actually been generated. It's not that there, well, some amount of culture of fear has always been there, but not to the extent to which it has risen. I would only add to this that even when I go somewhere, I find that even in the city of Baroda, in a corner, say that this is, it is Hindu, this area belongs to. Even in villages, I found hoardings like that. Now, where does it come from, and how does it function, how does it work? And there are all kinds of minorities which, so in some ways I am using the term minority in a slightly different context, and I want to say that it is through which, if an artist practices and he is still addressing, whom is he addressing? Is he addressing a crowd? Well, after you have made the painting, it belongs to the rest of the world, so it belongs to everybody, I mean, but does it address? Or is it being viewed by as many people? When it is being viewed by as many people, then what happens is what happened to Hussein. So it is interesting in that sense that the kind of a culture which spreads and which goes around through various means, you know, brings with it variety of problems and variety of, I have not explained myself very well, but I have tried to put some kind of a focus on some of the issues about practicing, you know, being in it, and to face it and to find how, and I'm very, in some ways, I would like to say that in the last 20 years or so, I think the artist has found various means. And they have, in some ways, I'm very happy to say that many have actually confronted the issue frontally. Now, this is something which is, despite, this is nothing to do with the techno culture, you know. It is within the culture in which they belong. And it is very interesting that in my time, when I was a young artist, the culture that existed in the world of art did not allow us to go political. Politics was regarded as something which was outside the realm of culture and art. So it was a sort of an apolitical, not that there was no politics, every act is political in that sense, but in those days when we were growing, it was that kind of thing, and anything that you painted which had a very direct content was termed illustrative. Illustrative was a kind of a term of maligning. Now, today, I'm very happy to say that not only these two aspects have not only been embraced, but have been explored fully by a couple of generation of artists, and these words are no longer the meanings that they carried in those days. So I'm very terribly happy about the whole thing, but at the same time, the situation is quite complex, far more complex than what it appears to be on the surface. Thank you.